Hello, thank you for the nice welcome. That's as Andrei introduced me, I'm Piotr Nowojski, I'm Apache Flink committer, and today I will be talking about how we can try to make checkpointing in Flink faster by using concept of unaligned checkpoints. But before we get to this, I would like to have some recap of how checkpointing in Apache Flink works currently. What is the alignment? What are the limitations of it? And then we will move on to unaligned checkpoints. What does it mean? How do they work? When to use them? What are the limitations? And what's the current status of unaligned checkpoints proposal? So let's start with unaligned checkpoints. As you probably know, checkpointing in Flink revolves around the idea of checkpoint barriers. Checkpoint barriers are meta markers that are flowing within your data stream. And for checkpoint barrier N, all records preceding the checkpoint barrier N are considered part of this checkpoint. How does it work on a larger scale? Here we have some example job graph where with operators and network channels between them. And if Flink decides to take a checkpoint, it injects checkpoint barriers at the sources of the job graph. And then the checkpoint barriers start flowing through the job graph, reaching successive operators. Once some operator receives all checkpoint barriers from all of the input channels, that's when it's taking snapshot of its state, and then it forwards the checkpoint barriers down the stream. Why do we have to wait for all checkpoint barriers from all of the input channels? This is to maintain consistency and to synchronize checkpoints between different operators. Because when we will, in future, if we will want to recover from such state, we want to make sure that all of the operators are synchronized, that the state of the operators is logically in the same point of time. So let's now zoom in at how does it work for single operator. Here we have example of an operator with two input channels and one output channel. And they are represented here on the slide from perspective of task manager. So the input channels and output channels are basically buffers. Flink buffers some data for performance reason. And let's say that network stack received a checkpoint barrier from the second channel. That's at this point of time, we cannot do anything. We just enqueue the checkpoint barrier at the tail of the input buffer queue. And the operator must keep processing the records and pulling the records from the input buffers. As it happens, the checkpoint barrier will traverse through the input buffer toward the head of the input queue. Once it reaches the head, that's still not the time when we can perform checkpoint. Why? Because we still haven't received checkpoint barrier from the first input channel. So the only thing that we can do now is to block the reads from the second input channel, and all of the successive reads will be happening from the first input channel. At some point of time, we will receive checkpoint barrier, but again, this is not time when we can perform the checkpoint. We still need to wait for the checkpoint barrier to travel through the input buffer, to wait for the operator to process the records that are stored in those buffers. And only once all of the input channels have the checkpoint barriers at the head of the input buffers, that's when we can snapshot the state and we can forward the checkpoint barrier to downstream operators. However, one thing more to note here is that we still haven't sent the checkpoint barrier to downstream operators. We just enqueued it at the end of the output buffer queue. So before we can finally send this checkpoint barrier to downstream operators, we still need to wait for the data from the output buffer to be drained until checkpoint barrier will reach the head of the output buffer queue. Now, why is it problematic? Because under back pressure, when all of the buffers are filled in, checkpoint barriers will propagate slowly. For in some extreme cases, if your if you have huge cluster with lots of buffers and records that are relatively slow to process, it can take even hours. Not for the, and I'm not talking about the synchronous or asynchronous part of checkpointing, but just the time for the checkpoint barriers to propagate from the sources to the sinks. This is causing long end-to-end checkpoint duration, which in turn means that in case of failure, we have to recover from earlier point of time than we would preferably like to. For example, if we can set up checkpointing to happen every 15 minutes, that's better than if we are forced to set up checkpointing every 1 hour. Secondly, the problem is with long checkpoint durations causing high end-to-end latency for exactly one sinks or sources. Basically, every operator that has to commit some kind of side effects to the external systems, it can commit them only on the completed checkpoint. So the longer checkpoint duration, the longer we have to postpone committing those kind of side effects. Also, there is one more issue if we with long alignment times that are blocking channels. Imagine a scenario where we have one operator with lots of input channels, and we have received almost all of the input checkpoint barriers, but we are waiting for one last lingering checkpoint barrier. Until we receive this checkpoint barrier, we are blocking input channels from most of the upstream job graph. So, in other words, we are wasting CPU resources of the cluster. Our proposal, how to solve those idea, is called unaligned checkpoints, and it works by the core of the idea is that we want to allow checkpoint barriers to overtake in-flight data. Maybe this slide will present it reasonably good. Imagine that we have some situation where, as previously, with operator and some checkpoint barriers in the input buffers. Instead of waiting for checkpoint barriers to progress to until the heads of the input buffer queues, we will want the checkpoint barrier to overtake all of the buffered data, to enqueue it at the tail at the head of the output buffer queue, and immediately emit it downstream. Now, to make it work, to not lose any data in case of failure, in case of recovery, the downside of this approach is that we will have to make all of the data that we have overtaken, those data must be part of the checkpoint or save point. In case of failure, the idea is that instead, not only have to recover the state of the operator, but we also want to recover the state of the input buffers and output buffers as they were at the time that we were overtaking the in-flight data. Now, the obvious downside of the unaligned checkpoints is that it will increase checkpoint size. So there will be some natural trade-off between more I/O, more heavily I/O versus checkpoint latency. But it boils down to a question, if we want to make checkpointing faster, is it faster for your particular job to spill the data or to wait for it, for the data to be processed by aligned checkpointing? So this is the trade-off here. Let's talk a little bit about the increased checkpointing size. For now, let's ignore flat map operators, where I mean flat map operators are the kind of operators that for one record can emit more than one output record. Let's assume that this doesn't happen. In this case, max size of persisted data that can happen in an aligned checkpoint is more or less sum of all network buffers in the cluster. On the upside, this is configurable value. On the downside, it's cluster-dependent or job-dependent, and with quite high, with larger jobs or higher parallelism jobs, it can easily reach gigabytes per task manager. to talk how can we circumvent this issue. Let's talk about how we can actually, when do we want to actually trigger overtaking the data. One idea is that we can trigger an aligned checkpoint immediately when we see any checkpoint barrier anywhere in the input buffers. Then we can immediately trigger unaligned checkpoints and persist all of the in-flight data from this channel, from output buffer, and all of the data from this channel, and all of the data that will come in until we receive checkpoint barrier. The advantage of this solution is that checkpoint barriers will propagate across the whole cluster within milliseconds, basically as quickly as is the latency of the network channels. The downside is that we do not know precisely how much data will have to be persisted. And here is the problem with flat map, because if behind this input channel there is some busy flat map operator that's producing millions of records on the output, the amount of data can be arbitrarily large. Another idea is that we can limit the in-flight data to configure it for example, 100 megabytes or something like that. The downside is that then we must wait for checkpoint barriers to arrive somewhere in the input buffers. Even if our limit is very large, we still need to see checkpoint barriers somewhere. So this will be much somehow slower than the previous option. However, the upside is that we have now fully controllable checkpoint size. One thing to note here, despite this being slower than the previous option, it will be still faster than fully aligned checkpoint, because we will still be able to overtake some or most of the data. One more thing to note here is that if we limit the amount of data, in-flight data, to zero, that's the equivalent of the current alignment algorithm. So let's talk about the benefits of the unaligned checkpoints. The biggest benefit is that, especially under back pressure, we can expect faster and more predictable checkpointing. More frequent checkpointing, as I mentioned before, means less data to pre-process in case of failure, but also lower end-to-end exactly once latency. Downside is mostly related to the larger and larger state and higher I/O usage. If your cluster is already I/O bound, that might not be a very good idea. Also, the downside is longer recovery time, because we have to not only restore the state of the operator, we also have to read the data, persisted data, unspill them. And also, before we will be able to process any new incoming data, we have to first process the unspilled data. So in other words, aligned checkpoints, checkpointing will take significantly longer, but recovery is faster. Here is the opposite. Also, another limitation is that propagation of the checkpoint barriers can still be slowed down by blocking calls in user code. Like, for example, blocking I/O, state access, some very heavy state access or something like that. However, this is not a limitation of just unaligned checkpoints, but the current aligned checkpoints also suffer from the same limitations. So, a couple of final words. What's the current status? Currently, this idea of unaligned checkpoints was proposed as FLIP 76, and it's under discussion by the community. Some preliminary and independent work has already started. We are also still evaluating the impact of the checkpoint size increase on the job. We are also considering some options how to mitigate this issue. And assuming that we will resolve the discussions and those issues, those questions quickly, we are hoping to introduce this feature in Flink 1.10, which is probably unlikely, but more likely we are aiming for Flink 1.11. That would be all from my side. Thank you. And do we have any?
Thank you very much, Piotr, for the great presentation. Now let's have some Q&A session. Any questions?
Just to understand if I got it right, what you should save as in-flight data, only the input buffers, right?
Yes. Input and output buffers.
Also output. So that means that when the checkpoint hits the sinks and you are doing the checkpoint, anyways, you should wait for...
Currently, that's exactly this is happening with aligned checkpoints. Sinks, they do not checkpoint immediately. They also have to wait until input buffers are fully drained. So with unaligned checkpoints, we will just add an option to take part or all of the input buffers as a part of the checkpoint.
Okay, I see. Or anyways, if at least one of the inputs hasn't, but you trigger the unalignment when every input buffer has got at least one barrier, right?
It depends.
That's the moment in which you trigger your unaligned checkpoint.
That's the difference between this option of triggering immediately, where we can trigger on the first checkpoint barrier that we see anywhere in the input buffers, or if we want to limit the in-flight data, we have to wait for checkpoint barriers to be present somewhere in all of the input buffers so that we can calculate the size of the in-flight data.
Okay, now got it. Thank you.
Hi. And what happens if you as a user just reduce the size of the input buffers and output buffers? Would that improve the performance?
Sorry?
What happens if you reduce the size of the input buffers and output buffers? Since the checkpoint size, there are less things, would that improve the performance?
Both for the aligned checkpoints and for the unaligned checkpoints, yes. Like, it depends. The trick with the buffers, any kind of buffers, is that we have them for performance reasons. So they should be as small as possible to maintain the throughput that you want. Currently, the problem is that Flink by default has quite aggressive settings with quite a lot of buffers to accommodate very high throughputs, while usually most of the jobs are do not have throughput of, for example, 1 million of records per second per operator. So if we have lower throughput, then we can try to configure checkpoint buffers to be smaller, and this will improve the alignment time. So for the aligned checkpoints, that would speed up the checkpoints, and for the unaligned checkpoints, that would of course decrease the size of the persisted in-flight data. But this is independent problem.
And one more question. Is there any difference between the semantics? Is it at least once or exactly once for the checkpoints? Because in one case, you're okay to have duplicate data, in the other case, you want to make sure there's no duplicate data.
There is a difference. Like at least once checkpoints. For at least one checkpoints, we do not have. For at least once we are never blocking the input channel. We don't have this alignment this problem, but still checkpoint barriers are flowing through your job graph. So you still have the problem of checkpointing taking long time, because the checkpoint can be taken only once all of the checkpoint barriers were encountered.
Is there also a serialization overhead here? Because we send all the input buffers and in-flight data.
Mostly no.
Yeah.
Sometimes yes. Unless you do not have a problem that you have to scale up or scale down from an aligned checkpoint, then there will be no deserialization cost. It's more a question why it's a bit longer. We can discuss later, or I can recommend you to read the Flip 76 proposal, which it explains a little bit. But assuming that you do not downscale before taking unaligned checkpoints and recovering from the such kind of unaligned checkpoints, there will be no serialization or deserialization cost because all of those buffers are already serialized to the byte form, and this is for unaligned checkpoints we will be persisting those bytes. So no extra serialization cost.
Thanks. So are you thinking to support this for incremental checkpoints since 2 or just for normal checkpoint and incremental checkpoints after?
What do you mean incremental checkpoint?
There is it with RocksDB, there is option to have incremental checkpoint in.
It would be difficult. I think this is one of the alternative or one of the things that we are also thinking about. Because one of the problems with unaligned checkpoint is that at the time of the checkpoint you will have to persist at this moment. At this moment you will have to persist, for example, 200 megabytes of data, which might take long. It might be even 2 gigabytes of data. To make it incremental, I don't think this could be fitted into this solution, but if we would be using persistent communication channels, so that if we were to persist every record continuously as we are trying to send it over the network, so send it over the network and persist it, then we'll reach this kind of incremental behavior.
Thank you very much, everybody, for coming. Thank you, Peter, again, for the presentation. Yeah, that's the end of the talk then.
Thank you.